Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Jackson County Board of Supervisors meeting for Tuesday, April 30th of 2024. With me today, I have Don Schwenker, Nan Flagle, myself, Mike Steinitz, are your county supervisors. Lisa Smith is our county auditor.
Good morning.
B. Horn is our IT director. Luann is our executive assistant. Mary is with the press. And first on our agenda today is Jennifer Mashandi, our insurance agent.
I think I'm just here to follow up on cyber.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, you know, I asked last week about if you were interested in purchasing cyber liability insurance, and I thought it was best just to bring Jennifer back to answer any questions that you have concerning that. She just needs a yes or no.
I just need to know if we're going to keep the quote active or if we're closing it. Yeah. Or
so we had several different numbers.
Yep.
Have we, I mean, I asked Bjorn to look into some of it, maybe what might be an advantage to him, IT, or so what we're covered. Did you come up with any conclusions out of that?
I gave a couple to Lisa, and we talked about it briefly, and where we're at right now.
So,
is there a recommendation of which policy to follow, deductibles versus premium, all that?
So the company that Bjorn and I kind of were targeting, if you want to have the cyber liability insurance, the company that we felt best fit Jackson County is this Tokio Marine HCC. It's a Neck Guard Plus. The only question I have, Jennifer, is in looking at this, what's a $30,000 deductible versus a $50,000 retention?
No, it's not those ones where you got highlighted.
Is that what the deductible is, $30,000?
Mm-hmm. On $2 million worth of limit. And retention, so that's a different carrier. They're using retention the same way as they would use deductible. The way a retention works, you know, like an attorney asks for the retention up front, deductible is after the top. It's just a different thing.
Okay, all right. We noticed that. I just want to make sure.
Yeah, it's a different carrier. It's Traveler, so $50,000 would be their deductible, essentially.
And premium?
$12,012. If... And looking at
12,012, I'm sorry.
12,012. So that would be option two.
Option one was for $2 million worth of coverage. And so the total premium with the policy fee is actually $13,192. Option two was the $2 million or the $12,012. It's just the way that the columns are a little bit different in what is there. So the one.
Oh, I guess I don't know what coverage means, and I'm not an IT expert by any means.
That's why you defaulted
and,
before to
yeah,
Bjorn.
And I just wonder sometimes again, is $2 million sufficient if we get held ransom? I want to call it. I mean, it sounds pretty minimal to me at this point of the game.
How much of our monetary transactions are done ACH or electronic transfer? Because to me, that's where we might open ourselves up to the biggest risk is somebody snagging and rerouting electronic transfers.
You know, you have ACHs that we all have our payroll is ACH. So, of course, all county, I'd say most county employees, I can't say all, most. Have our paychecks ACH. It's a requirement. We also have, when we do claims here on Tuesdays, a lot of those, not all, again, I don't know if it's 50-50. I'd have to go back and look. But you also have other, do we have any problems as far as people using credit cards?
No.
Okay.
I mean, we have a couple offices that do.
But there's no.
But we're protected somewhat through the credit card company for that.
Okay. I mean,
that's more on the credit card company.
The thing is that I'm more concerned about is that just like what happened in another county where it happened in another piece of government, you know, and came back to county government. So, you know, we interact with city clerks and you know, we interact with a lot of people. So that's one of my concerns. The other concern that I have is that we have so many employees here and it would just take one to click on something bad.
So do you see in the industry locally, I should say, because we are rural, I don't want to put it out there and say, hey, we don't have insurance. You know, I mean, hello.
We just did.
It's like, seriously, I mean, do you see in the industry that in rural, not just Iowa, be it whatever, South Dakota or whatever, I don't know.
We call them soft targets.
They call it
soft targets.
Yeah.
And it's because we don't have the same robust policies, procedures, yeah, firewalls, etc. And so you're a soft target for the opportunity for a cyber hacker or a bad actor, as they refer to them. And they get in, and if
that's
they,
reverse
they
psychology
in,
to me, that's what that sounds like.
I don't have enough knowledge to explain the dark web and all of that good jazz. I just know that, you know, municipalities, any entity that is, you know, that
now Mary's going to write about it. Now we're ours, folks.
We can find all the data already on there.
Yeah, I have to also understand, just to throw it out there. So it's, we have to put on so many different layers because of elections, because of our, you know, so we have to.
So are you covered through the same entity, or are you covered through what? Through this new policy, or where we are right now? I got to tell you, in 64 years, how old am I? 64. I've never heard enough more about insurance in the last 6 months than I have in 65 years. I'm telling you.
Well, I mean, it is a thing, because that's you're hearing more about weather and you're hearing more about cyber. It is the way of the world, Mike. I mean, unfortunately, how did this come about? We offered it at renewal time because you didn't have it, so it's something that we brought to the table at that time.
Well, I can tell you, I'm sensitive to this right now because with my private practice, we send our insurance claims out to through clearinghouses and stuff. And the major clearinghouse in the United States that processes pretty much all of the insurance claims, they got hacked, and people didn't get paid for like 2 months. And they're still, that happened in February, and they still haven't figured out how they're going to fix it. And it literally shut the industry down for a while. And that's not that's medical, that's everything. And it's just because of click or whatever. So that's the kind of stuff we're the world we're getting into.
I would agree with you 100%. My point is, if that comes to fruition, something like that's happened, I still see the insurance company, whether we have coverage or not, still arguing with it, saying, well, who's liable here? You know, I mean, I can see that happening.
Well, when you're going to turn in your claim, and just like any other claim, they're going to work it to validate whether the claim is just to pay. And if it's really what happened, they're going to pay based on your policy that is written. I mean, no different than hitting a squad car with a squirrel or whatever. You know, we hit the squad, we still have to figure out who's at fault for the accident or another vehicle, and then we make payment based on that. And that is insurance.
Because we're hooked to the internet and because of the elections and such, every year, Bjorn, everybody in my office and Bjorn, we have to take this cybersecurity training. Every year I have to do it. I just got done doing it. It was 9 modules.
Yeah, 2 hours.
It's about phishing and swatting and.
I mean, we do that too,
but nobody else in the courthouse has to do that,
right? To that extent,
that's right.
We do a
we do in the auditor's office, but nobody in the courthouse has to do that.
So, are we looking at what kind of period from what to what?
Well, we initially started the quote in January.
So we don't need all the quotes to move it.
So far, the quote is still good. I need to validate if you're going to move forward with it or keep it active, what I'm doing. So we're down to the wire now. The other day when I sent the email, you had 30 days left for it to continue to stay an active quote before I have to put it back through the cycle again.
Would it run with the current or the next fiscal year? Is that logical?
Or is it going to go from a year from
We can ask for a short policy. And I mean, I've never asked for a cyber short policy before where we would start it now and run it until January 1 and then renew it in January.
So it would run your calendar year, though. I'm talking fiscal year. Could we run it from our fiscal year?
See, our insurance renews March 1st.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's the question is, do we run it March 1st or do you want to run it July 1st or...
I don't want to run it at all, but I'm just saying.
Well, I mean,
am I obligated to? Probably. I don't know.
I think we definitely need to look at it with the world that we're living in.
Well, are you so?
I would say, can we keep it active and
I guess I don't know anything about it. I just know we need it. It seems like the world we live in, it's a necessity. So what I'm looking is at the three of you, or the two of you, Jennifer and Bjorn, or all three of you, at least the two, you got a bunch of policies. I look at it, I don't care if it's in Spanish or Chinese or what. I don't know what it means.
Well, I followed your
recommendation
over there.
That's right. Yeah.
I followed your recommendation and provided
go all back and say this is the one that best suits for us.
Well, he did that
with our safeguard.
I mean, now your people are telling you this one, the Tokyo Marine option number two, if that's what I'm indicating that you are all saying.
You know what? I don't sell insurance. I don't know. I mean, I'm doing the best I can.
Tokyo Marine option number two, do you feel that?
We put together three options that we felt were all very good.
Good.
Okay. And so we.
Is there a reason you
do pick the other?
Probably premium.
Cheaper premium. $2 million coverage.
But it has everything else that pretty much you think.
It looked like they had some interactive
extra security measures that we can set up for employees, it sounded look like to me.
Okay.
Again, we are not budgeted for this, correct?
We are not.
So,
where would it come out of?
Our ending fund balance.
I guess it would come out of the supervisor's budget.
Mm-hmm. Because the insurance is budgeted through this office.
So that's what I'm saying. We have the current fiscal year we're in, and then after July, so what's our coverage run from? We're long past March.
For your ICAP policy, correct. Do you want to work towards a July 1 date for this specific policy?
I would say.
This is almost May 1.
March with everything else.
You want to go to March? Okay.
Otherwise, you're just going to get missed.
March 1st. So you want me to see if I can write it effective immediate and then to March 1 and then March 1 out. Okay, we will see if we can do that. And then for clarification purposes, when the app is put together, are we DocuSigning, we're sending it to you guys to DocuSign that, or are we sending it to Lisa to DocuSign?
Whatever, what's procedure?
Do we do the other insurance?
It has been sent to Lisa.
We still have to approve it, is that correct? Yeah, we haven't done any of that yet.
Right.
So are we waiting to see a number, or what are we doing?
I think they said the number. It would just maybe change because it's a shorter premium.
A good on the effective dates.
What's the wishes of the board?
I guess I would like to see before we officially approve it if they can match it up with our March dates and if everything goes with that, bring it back for approval.
Okay.
Keep it on the agenda, Luann.
Yep.
I will reach out to them and see if we get that done, and then I will send an email back, and we'll go from there. If it's not available, do you want to have a second plan?
What do you mean by not available?
If they say nope, when you make it effective, it's a 12-month policy from that effective date.
Okay, then
what's the plan B?
What the number is and what the premium is. And
we're done.
You're
good
on your
page,
right?
And even pay the light
bill. Don't drink water.
Then act. It's hybrid. That's right. Mark the plan.
You will be late.
Who shot it? All right.
Thank you.
Is that fair enough?
That's all right. Good for today.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Thank you.
Jaden, are you guys in a hurry? I mean, no. You're scheduled at 9:25.
Really,
is that okay?
Schedule's all about 9:25.
Yeah.
9:30.
Okay. Otherwise, I would ask Jaden to yield, but as long as you're willing, we're still on schedule. So.
This won't take too long.
Okay. Right. We're joined by Mr. Jaden Sheckle, our assistant county engineer. Good morning.
Good morning. First on the agenda is a utility permit for ITC. This is for our 184th. Avenue Bridge that's going to be replaced this summer. This is the last utility, I believe, that needs to relocate. So it was MMEU's line, but ITC bought it from them. So they're just bumping out to our proposed right-of-way. And we met out there with Dan Schrader last week, and everything was fine with Dan, where they planned on going with those transmission lines. So pretty straightforward for us. So we recommend approval.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I have a motion and a second to approve ITC Midwest
C, rear location permit for utilities. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
Next is a couple of entrance permits. The first one is for Sean Hare, Nancy Collins. So it's Sean Hare's mother-in-law. It's an existing farm entrance. They're just looking for a 911 sign. Sounds like in the past there was maybe an accident or ATV rollover and nothing too severe, but just like a 911 address for that driveway in case if something were to happen, you know, it's easily not easy to identify where roughly where they're at. So
do we normally do that just for?
I don't know what our past practice had been. I mean, to me, I don't see an issue with it because it's not like we have just so many addresses to give out. I mean, each we come up with the addresses based on each road segment and where that driveway falls within that road segment. So it's not like once we issue this or this address, it's not like, oh, this one, it's not like we shorten our list. I mean, it's just based on where that, trying to think or explain.
I just know in the past we haven't done it.
Well, we've talked about it before, what's required and what initiates the need for a 911 address. And I was under the assumption that you had to have electricity at the location.
I don't know if that's...
Maybe that's not the case, but that was my...
In order for you
to pay electric to provide service, they do need an...
Need another. Okay, maybe that's where...
So it's not really us dictating that. It's more the utility companies like, we won't provide you service until... There is an address.
But then there doesn't have, there doesn't need to be a facility of any kind, no building, no structure of any kind.
I mean, I guess if they're going to run electric, there'd almost have to be for something, whether it's lights and a building.
Well, we certainly want our emergency personnel to know where we're at.
I just know in the past we haven't because I fell into that.
Otherwise, I don't have an issue. I don't have an issue either way, to be honest.
I wanted it for the exact same reason because I knew we were going to be clearing timbers and stuff like that. And I'm like, if something happens, I want to be able to say, go to this address versus now I got to remember a neighbor here or neighbor there's address and go to the third driveway past, you know.
Yeah,
that's almost impossible.
I guess as of recent, we've been doing it more because I don't know if you guys recall it. It's probably been a few months ago on Centerville Road. There was one for Steve Capacious that was this sort of the same deal. I mean, nobody lived back there. There's some old buildings, but same thing. He wanted an address just for emergency.
Looking back there, yeah.
So I guess in the past, yeah, it maybe hasn't happened, but I guess I don't see an issue with it because, again, it's not like, I mean, you go 100 feet north or south of this existing driveway, it's going to be a different address because it's just that much further down the road. So it's not like we're eliminating addresses from other people.
Right. I'll make a motion to approve it.
Second. I have a motion and a second to approve the entrance. Actually, basically, they're just providing an entrance permit. Is that correct?
Yes. So it's since it's never been a, it's been a driveway that's been there for before we had our system. So
so they're just applying for a farm entrance.
Yep. And I guess I should, it's in the Butler Township, section 36.
Yep.
South
so I have a motion and a second to approve the farm entrance and as presented. All those in favor say aye.
Right.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
Next is a residential entrance on 90th Street, which is the level B portion of 90th Street. And in your packet, you have the, should have the letter, the notarized letter that you recall we probably discussed this a while back. Or you seen the letter prior to it being notarized about, we sent them the, drafted this letter, attached with it the level B ordinance stating what we do or don't do as far as level B goes, and that we have no intention of increasing the roadway classification from a level B to a level A, that they would agree to pay for any rock hauling on that stretch of road. And as of last week, we just got the notarized letter back saying that he, you know, acknowledged all of that. So I know it's
hold us liable if that road's muddy and emergency services can't get there.
Mm-hmm. So if you approve a residential permit entrance and we're not obligated to maintain it then to the point that accessible to emergency services.
Minimum, I don't know. It's minimum maintenance. I mean, it's
and we can't limit people access as well.
I hear you. So I am exactly, I'm exactly hearing what you're saying. After the fact, we go ahead and say, yeah, you can have a residential entrance here. Now all the kids have to, well, you give me the permit for a residential entrance. Now you need to maintain it. Is there,
I don't know. I guess I could talk to John. I mean, I don't know. That would be kind of covered by him having this notarized letter acknowledging the level of the ordinance and all that. Because I know it states something that brush cutting will not be performed. Routine blading will not be performed. I mean, all that stuff. And ordinances are county law. But I hear you, Jane,
and I agree with you. I'm just saying I don't want to get sued 5 years from now again because something happened here and we couldn't get in.
Well, I agree.
And we have emergency here. We can't get there.
I do know just south of here on 90th Street, on the Level B portion, there is a residential entrance already on that road. And trying to come full circle here, remember – Todd has talked about where we're doing this Level B stuff. Well, part of that is I've noticed that on this street specifically, on the Level B part, it looks like it's been rocked routinely, you know, whether I don't know if they pay for it or not. But
if I understand it right, don't a school bus even go down and pick up kids at some time?
It could, and I have asked our snowplow, our grader operator that snowplows that, just like, I need to be honest, have you snowplowed that Level B? And he's like, yes, because that's what I've been told in the past. I'm like, that's fine. I just need to know. So as we address this stuff, we know which way, how to correct it. But I don't know.
I mean, I don't want to be treating this Level B this way and this Level B this way. And
that's what we're trying to do.
Because I know my grader, I get this privileges. And
that's what we're trying to clean up. Because I think that currently happens in areas. And I'm not trying to look at anybody, but I just... We're trying to clean that up so that way it's fair for everybody.
And I'm okay with it. I'm okay with giving him the entrance permit. I'm okay with it. Well, residential, but
you want to talk to John first?
Yeah. I would like that. I would like clarification to say, if we give you the residential permit that you can put it in there, are we obligated to maintain it because of emergency services?
Okay. Yeah,
that's not right.
Yeah.
I can do that.
Motion to table. I got a motion to second the table until we gather further information. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
Then last is roadway maintenance agreement. So every year the DOT sends us a maintenance agreement for snow and ice control on the Maquoketa Caves State Park. So it's only by lane miles, it's 0.72 lane miles. So 0.36 each way. It's just literally through the park. They increased the rate for this upcoming year from, when did it take effect? From July 1st to June 30th. So don't really have any way to verify, you know, since we don't have the sensors on the truck yet, to verify how much sand or salt we spread, time we spend on it. But again, it's only through the park, and we have to go through the park to continue on to our portion of, what is that, 98th Street. So, I mean,
I think
the time it takes is, but this is just the annual agreement.
It is annual agreement, and we want to be good neighbors. And
what's the cost?
Do you want it total?
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be $23.15 per lane mile. So at 0.72.
What's the over? What, 15 or 1600?
Yeah, so $1,676.06.
Yeah. You need a motion to?
Yes, recommend.
I'll make that motion to go ahead and approve the Iowa DOT maintenance thing.
Second. Motion second to approve the maintenance agreement with Maquoketa State Park. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
And that's all I had. A quick update on 308th Street. They are paving as we speak on phase two today. So I guess if you guys get a chance and care to go see it, they'll probably be paving till
mid-afternoon.
What's that?
Till it rains.
It ain't raining today.
Did you get an update on the taking the level C to a B or an A?
Oh, we haven't looked at that yet. We haven't got a chance to go out there and look at it to get a quick survey to get cost yet. So I didn't include that on this week's.
I'm worried about the drifting.
On that one. On the discussion from last week's?
Yeah.
That one? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't got a chance. To be honest, I haven't got a chance last week to get out there and look at it.
Okay.
Thank you much.
Thanks, Jaden. All right. We are down to the visitor and citizens portion of our meeting, and I believe we do have some individuals here that I'd like to approach the board this morning. If you would please come forward, and I think we know some of us, and there's a few back here I don't
know. Yeah, I'll introduce a couple of you here. Thank you for working us in today. So this is Danny Davis.
Morning.
He is the Port Administrator for the 7th Judicial District. And back there in the black sweater is Jennifer Weiss. She's the new clerk of court here.
Nice to meet you.
So again, thanks for working us in. What we wanted to do is give you just a short, we don't want to take a lot of your time, but give you a short update on some of the projects the court administration is doing back in the district court area and in the clerk's office. And to give you an update on what that is, they're spending, I think it's approximately $90,000 on updating furniture and equipment and that type of thing, both in district court, the jury room, and in the clerk's office. But before we do that, I wanted to thank you for letting Jeff work with us on carpeting back there. I've talked to him. I know Jennifer has talked to him, too. He's been very, very helpful. That's going to be a really nice addition back there with carpeting and paint. And that'll go along, help us out a long ways. I think we've had a good partnership with the county over the last couple of years, maybe better than we have sometimes in the past. We were able to repurpose some of that office space to the county that we were underutilizing. So we're hoping to keep that going. And we do have a little ask for you here that you're probably aware of. But before we do that, why don't I have Danny tell you a little bit about what the project is back there without taking a lot of time.
So if you don't mind, I'm going to give you these are different things that we are doing. I have one copy of it, if you don't mind. So the clerk's office, that's the work that's being done in the clerk's office. And then the judge's area and then the also the jury room and spaces like that. So, you know, we're replacing most of the furniture and all the court area. The courtroom itself, there was some upgrades in the furniture. We are putting in a new witness chair, but in the judge's chambers, we're putting in new furniture in there. We're putting in new furniture in the jury room as well. And so all that's about $90,000. We've also upgraded all the electronics in the courtroom, you know, have all the audio visual latest stuff. And that's $70,000-$80,000 there that we've upgraded in the courtrooms as well. And, you know, one of the things we are doing is trying to make sure that, you know, Scott County is one of our larger counties and we get more furniture, but we want to make sure that these other counties in our district, whether they're smaller or larger, has latest technology and the best looking furniture that we can do things so that the citizens can be proud of when they come in, because you have people that come into the you know, the clerk's office all the time filing paperwork. We feel like that we need to upgrade that. I had some money that I've been saving, wanting to upgrade the furniture in the clerk's office for that reason. With these furniture, also we add the stand set desk, you know, that they can choose what height they want the desk to be at for the staff and everything. So it's the latest things. And it also provides security for staff, because even though it's not a complete, you know, somebody could still probably get through there. It slows them down if we have an issue, and they're not as tempted to be, you know, they may think twice before they just have an emotional reaction to what the courts are telling them. And so this is the way it was, we designed it. The one of the things that this layout is a little different because of the putting in the security measures and the stand desk and everything else. And it, so the way the flooring is now with the carpet and the tile, it makes it a little more difficult for the installation, and the way it looks wouldn't be as the way it, you know, wouldn't fit the furniture, wouldn't match the furniture. So, but we wanted to get this installed because I think it looks really good, and it will improve the staff's ability to do their job and make it a little more comfortable. And it looks good for the citizens coming in.
I think security is a big part of it for me. You know, the clerk's office can be a volatile place at times, not very often, but generally when people lose in court, their first stop is down to the clerk's office to pay something or do something. And, you know, we've had some incidents down there where people get pretty upset. Sure. That's why the locked doorway we thought was a good thing. I guess what we're coming to ask you for is to consider if you would consider putting new flooring in the front part of the clerk's office. I look at this as being a generational project. Frankly, I never thought I'd see the day where court administration at the state level would put $90,000 in a small courthouse like this. So I think it's great. A lot of that's been due to Danny's efforts and Jennifer's too. But so I think this is going to be something that's going to be in place for 20 years or more, probably more back in the district court area. And I think it would be great if we could get the flooring in now that would work for that. And we'll have this project done for a couple of decades. And it will provide better security for the clerk staff. And I think it would look nice for the public. And it's a lot cheaper than a lot of the other fixes that I've heard talked about over the years here, where maybe we put bulletproof glass up or change that into a counter so that people are out in the hall. This is a relatively inexpensive solution. So that's what we came to ask.
Okay, so a couple questions I have.
Sure.
Jeff, do you have a recommendation? Or, I mean, I went down this morning, looked over briefly. I don't spend a lot of time in the clerk's office saying that. But, I mean, again, our initial thoughts may be the front lobby area where they do interact with the cubicles, if you will. We thought maybe tile would be better for cleanup for mud or anything like that. I don't know if that's the case or not.
I mean, it's probably easier to clean up. The only concern I have is that, you know, sometime down the road when something changes, now you have to deal with that tile again. That's the only concern I have with that, you know, and the tile that goes back to that back room, I think is going to be not in a very good spot. It's going to be, part of it's going to be carpet. I think part of it's going to be tile. So that could be a little bit of a trip hazard as you go back through that door to that back area.
Is there a way maybe we could kind of compromise and keep the tile in front of where the people come in, but that aisle way back to the door, have that tile removed and have it so it's carpeted through the office area versus the entrance?
Yeah, that could easily be done. You know, we could save that, refinish that, probably put some new wax on it. Like I said, the only thing is if something moves, you know, then you run into that problem of, okay, now it's half on the tile.
They're here telling us this is a generational decision. Well, it won't change for 20 or 30 years, so I'm going to go with that.
So I guess I'm going to ask somebody that's been here longer than I am. Is there any kind of an agreement or as far as who pays for what or whose dime is this is on? We have leases. I know we're obligated to give you space, but I don't know what that includes.
The space includes the floor, you know, having the floor and painted walls. We put the furniture in. And the way I usually describe it is if it can be taken, then we pay for it. If it's a fixture, then the county pays for it. And that's the way, you know, so a floor is considered a fixture.
Yeah, I would say you're right there. I mean, I would say somewhat that is part of our building. It's part of our life.
Yeah.
So if it's nailed, glued, or screwed, it's a fixture. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I don't know that it says that, but I would say that's probably the case. I don't know that.
My biggest issue is we haven't planned on this, so it's not really in our budget anywhere. So,
and I wanted to apologize for that. That's not typically the way I like to do things. You know, I like to come to the board and say, hey, we're going to be putting this in. Think about, you know, next year and be a part of your budget.
Right.
Out of respect, that's the way. And I apologize. The reason this happened is we ended up with, and you know how that this goes. Sometimes you have a surplus, and we ended up with surplus money, and we wanted, Jackson was the one, the county is the one that needed the most work as far as furniture and upgrades. So we dedicated our funding to Jackson County because it is a once in a generational opportunity. I don't know when I will have this opportunity again to spend this money. So it's one of those things that, and so we wanted to lessen the cost for the county because of this. And that's why we are, you know, if carpet is a better way and you can blend it in, we are willing to work any way we can with the county from that perspective. And it, again, it's a respect issue, and I apologize for coming to you at the last moment. This thing's worked out. We've been working on this, trying to work on the drawings and come up with a solution. We have to get it done by June 30th. That's the state, you know, we have to have it installed by June 30th or the money goes away. And then I might not have any money to do this for several more years. And so.
Well, we don't want to get left behind. So, I mean, we appreciate that they are thinking of little old Jackson County, yeah. But just so we're on the same page, we need some quotes, I would say.
I said one thing to say, you know, so it is short notice.
Right.
So if we can get an installer to come in at their, you know, when it works for them, it might not be that convenient for the state, you know, but you know what I'm saying? I mean, so if I can get somebody to come in.
I think we'll work around that.
Yes.
We understand that. Yeah. We know it's short notice.
So the problem is, I mean, so let's say he says, oh, I got some three weeks from now, I can come and do that.
Yeah.
We have to tear out that furniture that's in there now. And then what do we do? I mean,
but we'll make it work. We'll work with our vendors and we'll work, you know, if it's, we'll make it work.
Okay. I'm, you know what I'm saying?
When are you guys trying to plan or do all this work?
Mm-hmm.
When do you
cut off before June?
Yeah, I mean, when do you, is your furniture in?
No, it's not.
Just waiting or ordered or?
My
expectation. Just the design is just done, right?
Yeah. My expectation, mid-June. But if the vendor says, I can do it the first part of June and it's two more weeks before we're ready, we'll make it work.
It's a little bit easier in the other two rooms compared to this room,
yeah.
If you understand.
Yes.
Well, they work out of this thing daily. Right. Yeah, I mean, they're there. So just so we stand each other, I'm going to call this a public area, even where these two desks are, correct?
Yes.
Right. Correct.
So are we going to have tile in the whole public area or just to the end of these cubicles?
I'd say the highlighted portion.
That's
where the tile is now. And I would say we cut the tile off right at the end of that cube.
So my point is, Don, is the whole, yeah. This whole area is employee. This whole area is public.
Right.
So are you making all the public?
I would say the main area where people are going to come and stand.
And not where these other two desks are? For the,
I guess is, what's the purpose of them other, like filling out paperwork and stuff like that?
Yes, we provide public access so that, you know, somebody doesn't have a computer at home because most everything has to be done through e-filing. And so they can come and use the equipment to scan their documents and everything. You know, they might not have a scanner and need to scan. So we give them access. And that's what
the public desk is for.
I agree that wall right before you get to the door, you know, that tile, if you leave that there and if you can carpet that rest of that public area, you know, where that little bit where that tile is, I would be very happy about that.
Good. I would say get a quote for that, doing it that way, and also get a quote for it just being all carpet, and we'll probably go with the cheaper one.
Let's see where
they're at. That makes sense. Tile in the public space, carpet in the
tile in the front three in front of here.
Yep.
And then this is carpet.
Okay, so just basically what it is now, except for that little.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then
we can walk down and take a look at it.
Get a quote for carpet, the whole thing also.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, thank you very much.
We'll see what we come up with. Yeah, I mean, I guess.
Let us know what you come up with.
We're not looking to spend a bunch of money, but we're looking to keep ourselves looking respectable.
Yeah, I think it'll look nice either way. All right, well, thank you.
All right, thanks, gentlemen. Jennifer, nice to meet you. Nice to meet you, Dan.
You're right.
All right, I'm gonna get back to, where was I?
Anybody else? If you have room for one more public comment?
Sure.
Okay, I would like to have Fair Board Manager Terry Selzer come up and discuss with you a situation.
Good morning, Terry.
Good morning.
You got a bad arm.
A bad shoulder.
Bad shoulder.
Bad shoulder surgery, so.
Oh, well, good luck.
Yeah, well, second time since June, so.
Yeah.
I'm getting good at one. So we had a situation with the new roof on Pearson. It started to leak. So I called Beckwith that put the roof on, and they came up and looked at it. And basically what happened is when we had the snow, when it thawed and the snow came off the roof, we called it the avalanche, it took out the pipe that vents the heat. And then the boot that was around it got damaged. So that's where it was leaking. So we called, he said that they wouldn't fix that. So we called Bernie's Heating and Cooling, and they came up and put a heavier duty pipe in there, and they were able to seal it. The other thing that he talked about was we have 14 damaged two-way air vent caps. And he said that every time it snows and we have that thawing and the snow goes down, it's going to destroy or knock off those air vent caps. So he sent us a bid, which I thought was kind of odd because I was hoping that was kind of under the warranty part. But anyway, we have a bid to replace the 14 damaged two-way air vent caps and then provide and install 33 snow ice diverters above the air vents to prevent future damages, which I'm not sure why that wasn't done to begin with, but it wasn't. So I don't know. I called Lisa because I didn't know, is that something that you guys want to be a part of? Is that something you guys, because you put the roof on, is that our responsibility? I don't know the answer to that question. So
I guess if I remember right, the roof, when we took responsibility and put that roof on, it was kind of a one-time deal, I thought, at that point. I mean, we knew it needed maintenance. I totally agree with you. There should have been ice guards on whatever is, I mean, if they put the roof on and they've seen it, that these vents could get damaged by a large slide, obviously we need some ice guards on it.
Right.
You know, whether they're just the little ones or I don't know what they call a,
What is the pitch on that roof?
It ain't much.
It's not a lot.
So, because that's what I'm thinking. I just have a hard time picturing an avalanche tie-in.
Yeah. Oh, no, it does.
You know.
We watched it. And part of the problem he talked about because of the snow and the melting so fast, that because of the amount of snow we had, the heaviness of the snow and the fact that it melted quickly, that's why we had this issue. But every year we hear the snow come go.
So when you put an ice diverter, it's like a little fin on the bottom. It kind of catches and holds things, right?
I would say it's on top, so I don't.
I don't know 100%.
So that it doesn't fall off on the bottom of the sheet metal roof or whatever. Keep it from coming off.
Yep.
To me, one of these air vent things would serve as the same kind of thing. It's something that prevents things from sliding because it isn't like the snow build up 20 feet of momentum,
right,
and hit the air vent. The snow is up against the air vent.
But it hit. I mean, it was enough momentum that it took out that steel pipe that was that heating.
Yeah,
I think we just had a freaky.
Yeah.
What have that?
Well, we did have 15 inches in 2 days. Yeah,
that heavy snow and then the rain on top of it, which caused. I'm sure water got under there and just kind of carried.
So may I ask what the bid is?
$2,633.
Okay, so you have a maintenance personnel there at the facility?
The problem is our maintenance guys can't put it on because it says all workmanship per manufacturer requirements to maintain the
warranty. Warranty.
Apparently, we don't
have. Yeah, it doesn't sound like there's a warranty because none of this stuff's been covered.
Well, it almost sounds to me, and I have not called them on this. She called me and she said, I'm going to send you a bid. And I thought, why are you going to send me a bid? Shouldn't these vents be replaced as part of a warranty? But obviously not. So I
don't know. That's obvious. They're not part of the roof, I don't think. But, well, they probably would be. But did they put the vents on?
They would have had to.
They put the vents on?
I would have assumed so.
I don't. You know, when I think of a vent, I think of a ridge vent or a, this must be something that's down further on the roof.
I don't know. He knew exact. He goes, oh, you've got a bunch of your air vent caps off and I need to replace those. So this was not a shock to him at all. So I think it's something that was on with the roof.
Yeah, you either get the ridge one or like 10, 15 feet.
So, and I think but still, they're not halfway down the roof or three quarters way down the roof. Are they?
No, they're towards the top. They're towards the top, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I would say this anyway. I don't know that your maintenance guy is going to fix it, but I would respect his opinion. And maybe we send our maintenance guy down there too to give an opinion.
Okay.
You know, and then I would address them and say, hey, we're looking into this. We feel like this should be somewhat covered.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, hiring them professionally, I would think they would have.
Again, if you knew this was going to happen.
I just can't believe because he was not shocked at all. He goes, oh, it's the avalanche that happens. And I'm like, okay. But then when he said, when we got this with the diverters, I'm like, well, we live in Iowa. Why wouldn't you put the diverters on to begin with? Why would you wait until after the fact when we're losing? And the problem is we didn't necessarily know those were off. So now the moisture that we've had is getting into the insulation. So we've got to do something, but I feel like we're stuck between a rock and a hard place that they didn't provide these to begin with. I don't understand why.
You have the original bid for the roof?
Probably in the file down there.
We have them too.
You probably have it.
Just to see if diverters were included on that bid, as you know.
Yeah, I'm sure we have the contract.
So okay. That would just be something.
I mean, obviously, if they're professionals and they were given this job, they would need to know what we need to protect ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Well, my concern is if we have somebody else doing work up there, I'm not concerned because they told us we had to have our HVAC guy come and put the new pipe in. And then he put a boot, he sealed it really good. So they don't need to come back and do anything with that. But I'm concerned we don't want to do anything that's going to void the warranty.
I would write a nice letter back and not so nice, whatever you want to consider to say. You know, we assume that some of this should have been done prior to cover.
And can I get the, I would assume Lanny would have had a copy.
I'm sure we have it because we did that project using ARPA funds. So I remember having to bring the contract in for signature. So I'm just trying to get a copy. And
If you can get a copy, then I will.
Yeah.
From that, then address this.
And then
caps have technically been off since probably the end of January.
Probably.
At least, because that roof is a couple of years old.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, four. Yeah.
Well, and I don't know that.
4 years old.
Three.
I think it was right before we came.
So technically, you don't know if it came off this winter
or last winter.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they've been off for a few months or year and a half.
Yeah, I don't know.
You know.
Okay. Well, we will have your maintenance guy look at it and see what his best advice is or recollection of what should have happened or what should have been done.
Okay.
And then hopefully we can send Jeff down there too and maybe take a look. Is that something we want to do?
Thank you very much. And
I'll
get it to you. Perfect. They're working on it now.
But you would think that there were some of these vent caps, if they came off in the avalanche, would be laying on the ground.
Well, they might be, and somebody picks them up and throws them away because they don't know what they are. No. You know, I don't. I've never seen one. He brought one in. I'm like, I've never seen it.
You know, I'm just like,
right.
One, yeah. Several? How many are up? 12?
Well, are they all off 14. Or are they just broken?
Well, he said some of them were off and some of them are broken. All right. Thank you.
Think you're somewhere with the snow.
All right. Thanks, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Next on our agenda is George.
Doherty and Elaine Edwards from the Jackson County Pioneer Cemetery. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you today?
Good. Beautiful day.
It is.
So we're here to talk about Russell Cemetery. And you were provided with two different letters that we were proposing to send to the landowner. The second letter was more of a introduction letter. And I guess my impression is I would like to start with the introduction letter, see if we get a response. If we don't, we may have to push it and go with the one that has more legal options in it.
Well, I would agree myself, George. I mean, we've talked about this, you know, between us, and I think it's a lot better to say hi and shake hands first before we say, hey, this is what the code of Iowa says. I think it's a nice gesture just to meet and make offer to meet, and if you don't get any response, I guess you'll kind of know. But
it's been sold so many times
since
we've had access, and so that the height of the problem is that we deal with one owner and then it gets sold before we can get anything started with them.
Yeah, we can't do anything about that. So, I mean, we just proceed as we can best see fit. Okay. And I'd like the letter that says, hi, we're neighbors, you know.
Anyone have any concerns with either of the letters?
I don't. No. I looked them over and county attorney looked them over. So I would start with your... You need action on that, or is that something you just want our approval and you go ahead and do, or what do we need to have action on that?
That's up to you. We just got on your agenda.
Okay. I think we could approve it. That means we'll have record to say it. We looked at it and read it anyway. Okay. And approved the introductory letter.
I'll make that motion to approve them mailing out this introductory letter.
I'll second it.
Motion and second to approve the Pioneer Seminary Commission to send out a letter of introduction. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
Are you okay if we don't get a response that we take the next step?
I would say bring it back to us.
If we add a time frame to this letter, we'd be interested in hearing from you by
30, 60, 90 days.
60 days out.
I think we did in one letter. I don't know if we did in the introductory letter. Might not have. So we need a time frame. I agree.
It says timely. I guess I was leaving this.
What's your definition of timely? And my definition of timely may be two different things. You know, if you guys are looking at getting in there in June, and I maybe think, well, as long as I contact you sometime this year, it'll be okay.
So I was thinking timely meant, if I don't hear from you within...
Well, the introductory letter says we would like to make ourselves available for a visit when it's convenient for you in the next few weeks. So,
yeah.
Maybe
that's reasonable. If like you say, it's in the crop portion of the field that, you know, obviously you're not going to be going through there if things are planted and growing.
Well, we probably can walk in to visit.
Sure.
Yeah.
We're probably not going to
make a plan.
Do
That's fine.
My intent was if we don't hear from them soon, I would attempt to call the attorney's office.
Yep.
Let's see
if we get a response.
Yep.
Keep us posted. Emails are good. We pass them on, pass them forward. We know what's going on that way. Everybody's in the loop.
Or you want me to
just send a response. If you get a response, let us know.
Okay. Very good.
If you go there,
thank you, guys.
Next on our agenda is Nathan Jones, our Jackson County Conservation Director. Good morning, Nate.
Morning.
Good
night. I'll make it short this week because it was probably the shortest one meeting I've ever had.
What?
The storms were coming in. It wasn't last.
So Last board meeting kind of discussed, but first of all, the harbor wall is complete, other than you got a little bit of dirt work, but it's usable now. That's Bruce.
Is the boat ramp in yet?
No.
It wasn't a couple weeks.
No, it isn't. No. Well, I don't believe that's a good question. I don't know if that is it or not. I haven't looked. I don't think it is, but I don't. Okay. Yeah. So, but that's all at least kind of on the wrap up, and the docks are usable.
Are you gonna see that?
That's on us. So I was telling the crew we'll probably have to rent something to do a finish, because that dozer just leaves those ruts, and then we'll get in there and see it. Wish I would sort of put that
in. You don't have a pulverizer of any kind.
What?
You don't have a pulverizer like that.
No, that's what I think I'd rent. Or try to see if Shekel or somebody would come in and give us a bid. But that needs seated pretty quick here. We can get some dry days in a row.
Yeah.
To do that. But that was the main thing at the last board meeting, was kind of discussing that. Discussing the Destination Iowa project. Water quality project starting to move forward. They got bids back. I don't know if the city has made any movement on it, but so those came back favorably in that $950,000 range for the water quality portion of that project. So we'll just wait and hear on what the city kind of council and wants to move on those, or who they select out of the bid pile there. I'm meeting with engineers out there this afternoon on the other portion of the Destination Iowa project. We did give Alex a deadline of June on the trail portion on that project to try to get that moving.
Has he been more communicative? Or?
Yeah. And I don't, you know, you got a permit and it's in 12 hands in the state. And if they're not giving him any feedback, he's not really got any feedback for us. Kind of thing.
Well, it sounded like it was the DOT portion. It didn't sound like it was a big deal, but except for it's going to take time, I suppose. I don't know.
Yeah.
But he said he was ready other than that portion of it. But.
Yep. So the last feedback from Alex was last Monday. He talked to the DOT lead and she said she had some minor changes that she was going to send them in the next few weeks.
So at least they looked at it.
So they have looked at it. That's the
We did make contact. It did make contact for with our engineer too, to say if he got any strings or any doors that he can kick open. That again, it's a process where you're at the mercy of time.
But with that being said, we gave him June 1st deadline. Our other option was move the trail. It sounds like the Destination Iowa money does not want us to move the trail. So we're pretty new back up. We're waiting on that permit no matter what. We have all the other permits in hand on that project. So that was kind of it was a very short board meeting. I think it's kind of funny they were talking about that snow on the fairgrounds, but we had the same thing happen in the center. It knocked the roof or the railing and a 2x12 off our deck when it came off this winter off the center. So
I was glad I had ice guards on between my house and my.
I can't believe when they built that center, they didn't put ice guards. Yeah, but I don't know how you would do it with that plastic shingle.
I can't imagine.
Roof. I don't know. But yeah, so that was about it. Campgrounds are well, Sabula's open. Spruce is going to probably, we've been waiting on some water, the people doing the water stuff. Sounds like we're probably just going to open it this week because they've got a few other things going on. They got the roads tore up at Spruce to put water lines in. But we'll probably. We were going to open today, but I told the crew to wait till tomorrow to save us money on water test, because we have to test our water the day we open. And we don't want to have to do one today and tomorrow because the month changed.
Oh, because of the month. Yeah.
So so we'll probably be opening tomorrow at Spruce.
Who does the water test?
Our staff does it.
Oh, do they?
Yep. So
that's something Elizabeth would do, isn't it?
I don't know if she does those or not. We just take samples and run them over here to check it out. So, but yeah, those places are moving and opening, mowing, starting, kind of wish the grass would quit growing this quick, but it's already May. So, you guys have any questions for me?
No, no, but speaking of water test and the up at ACIA, they were looking for people to do.
I don't think we want to run a person every day to town. Or to Makoka taking those tests. I know they brought that up to me. It's a daily thing.
Is it daily? Yeah. I didn't know what it was, if it was just a...
Yeah, it'll be 7 days a week. So I think they're going to need to find somebody living in that neighborhood that wants to...
Okay.
A retired person.
Would be great.
So, but yeah.
Oh, cool.
All right.
All right, Adam, thanks for the update.
Thanks. You guys have a good one.
You bet.
Bye.
John, are you in a hurry?
Always in.
You okay, Stormy?
Hey, I'm good.
You want to come up, John? We'll take here. You and
yep.
This guy can do his work as he sits there. I think he's pretty good.
Okay. Basically, I talked about the fair project first. There's no key for the max box. The fire department has the key, so when we put the master key in the Knox box and just shut it.
I have a master key, so don't you think they got it? Or do you, I mean, what key there are you going to put in the box?
The master one opens all doors but the one.
Don't I have them all?
Yeah.
So they're going to get a hold of me?
No, you need
need to put a key in there and just shut the door up.
Oh, there's no key for us to open it up. It's the fire department only.
I just wanted to make sure. I mean, I made the call last week and they were supposed to get a hold of me. I just didn't want to. Somebody needs to put it in the system, I guess.
Put
okay.
It in the
so it's a
911 said they didn't have it in the system that we have one there.
Yeah, they need to fill out paperwork.
I don't think
nobody said anything about it. So will you
the fire department typically will do
it.
The fire department typically has the keys.
Right.
The key to the box, yeah.
But
yeah.
To put it in the system for 911 that when they would get called down there
and shut the door.
Yeah.
But that's all I needed to know.
As long as they have a key to the back box, whatever you
can. Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure that I didn't want to shut the door if
you want to be down there.
Okay, really?
So we need to fill out some paperwork, and we have to have someone down there.
How's it here? She was going to talk
that. Well, when I called over to dispatch, I left my cell phone number and said, call me. And Terry was working on it because of Al. So we'll get it done. It's just a matter of
the logistics. Slam the door shut.
Doesn't sound like we can.
No. The key stays in it.
Huh?
The key stays in it, and you pull the key out. That's it.
Huh?
I just want to get it done. Yeah.
Yeah. I want to get it all done. So the 30th, they're going to come update the electrical software. I don't think there's any charge for that, but they need to update the software for the electrical, for the controls, because of length time project. And so that's being taken care of through Dwayne Stickley and whoever goes down there. I did buy some stainless steel corner guards from Gerard Fabrication, and Jeremy and I will put them on for you guys. All the final lien waivers, consent of surety, and final documents have gone out to the contractors, so should be able to close that job down pretty quickly.
How about the jail? Same thing?
Lisa, what about
I wish, thing? Yeah. Any questions on prayer yet?
Yeah.
What?
Okay, so, you know, John, I showed you our cheat sheet, so to speak, our colored sheet, and you emailed that to Chris.
Yeah.
And what have you heard back?
They're going to get taken care of.
Okay.
So
about that back door.
So we went down, we bought colored string. Colored strings were coded to a key, and then that transferred into a magic marker. And so we have on a schematic, I guess, of all of the keys and what they open. We did request a change. I did talk to John. We believe that the one door is probably a construction cylinder and not. So we requested to have that rekeyed. I believe that there's two outside doors that I think are actually switched. When you look at the colors of what we have, you should have purple on this side and blue on this side, and it was opposite. So we've requested to have that switched over. There was a broken door, an opener that we found. And so again, we've talked to John. John has sent that on, and hopefully that'll be, there were some issues.
It's been repaired already.
Oh, it has? Okay. Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, Billy was down there and took care of it. I met with him another day. And so things are getting taken care of.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Pete has been excellent to work with, and I don't know Billy's last name, but he's from Macocata or something. But anyway, he, yeah, that's it. And so he's been down there working on everything, and everything's been pretty much taken care of on the punch list. I went up and took care of the items there, and I met with him.
John, can you answer why that one west door is a different style door that, that goes to the outside off of the ISU? So that door, it has just a pin at the top and the bottom that basically you have to lock it to hold it shut, versus the other ones have the panic push bar that has a little lever. Because with that being their main door, they're going to be coming and going in and out of that. Just seems like an odd door for a public entrance. That like wind's gonna catch it or
I can check in that for you.
I mean, I don't know if like that door and the door on the back hallway of ISU could be flipped out, or I don't know. It's just an odd.
It's an aluminum storefront door, isn't it?
It only shut, it only locks with the key, and it does the pins going up and down.
Okay, I'll check on that for you.
And it's the only door in the building that I seen that was that way. Yeah. So it's an odd, it's just not.
Yeah, because the other.
And for that being a main door without having something that clicks to hold it, I see the wind catching that. You're going to have a sprung door real quick.
Okay. And as far as the back doors, they're working on, Billy's working on securing them, because I went down there last time. The one door has the east door of the conference room. Going out the back of the north side had the sweep and folded up underneath it. It wasn't real wet after they caulked it, but I felt a dampness, so Billy's taking care of that. And he's also going to take care of the other two doors. He's caulking along the bottom of the frame. I think it's getting in through the frame. The other time, though, they hadn't caulked around the precast in the door, and that's when it got real wet. Yeah. So working on that, the front doors had leaked a little bit.
I was going to say, the front door, when we were sitting there, could see in the bottom corner a little daylight.
Yeah, and up at the top, too, where the pins hit.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to replace that, but it got wet in there, and it will get wet sometimes without a center style in that, you know, because they're wanting to take equipment in and out of there. It's always a problem with that if you get a driving rain. But other than that, Jeremy and I got the countertops put in, and everything has been certified, so we should be ready to go. Any other questions on that particular project? Okay, as far as the jail goes, bring in security electronics. It's coming in the 12th. We should be dust free by then in the control room and everything. They got the rest of the frames put up. Jeremy and I worked over the weekend like a bunch of dogs and got the high stuff touched up and painted on that steel that we got from Girardi and such. So all upper painting's been done now. We're down the ladder just touching up paint on that. We worked on that Tri-City County some money, so that's pretty well done at this point in time. And we want to get the people in to finish the day room floors, you know, to finish epoxying them. Plumber and HVAC is going to be done today with most of their stuff. That I'm waiting on is to determine the washer, residential washer and dryer that we plan on using, so we can finish the ductwork down to the
residential washer and dryer.
Yeah.
So we thought
it was commercial.
We bought a commercial. Commercial's installed. The residential is it get a small, you know, like a small load, like you get somebody that you've arrested at dirty clothes or lice infested that you just throw a small load in that. But I'll bring that pricing back when they get it to me. Andrew and Sheriff working on that. We got some refrigerators that we need to determine, and that should buy out that. Most of the kitchen equipment's there on site.
Is it plumb for a residential washer and dryer too?
Yes. Yep. Plumb and electrical is ready for that. You were there this morning, so that most of I'm only waiting on the three bay sink in the kitchen. Just didn't want to take it in there yet with the amount of contractors going through that they'd get damaged. But want to keep them on that. So HVAC should finish up today and move their stuff out. Plumbing is working this week and next week to finish up all their stuff. Electricals, getting all the lights on and do the above ceiling next week so I can put the rest of the ceiling tile in. BRF system controls are going to be here to finish up and start up the main HVAC system up front this week. So everything is coming together right at the moment. So I figure the second week of June would be into the training process, first, second week of June, and the training process on security electronics and getting the contractors out of there. But I probably have to shut the job down for 3 or 4 days when they go to do the corridors, the epoxy, because there's a time limit on when those chemical reactions will work. So I'll move everybody out to the vehicle Sallyport to finish that up, but they won't be able to get in the main part of the jail portion. I believe SDI is pretty well done. Your contractors with the front and start doing the punch list, get her punched out and get her up and going.
We don't have no roof issues where we're going to have avalanches going on.
Ah, no, they're all done. Not the avalanches. No.
Well, I just want to ask, we've been talking about it.
Yeah.
You know, on either building.
This is minimally pitch roof, goes better, so it doesn't run outside the building.
But, no, what about the storage shed? Does that need ice cutters? Does that have?
I've never looked to see if it has
ice guards.
Whatever.
They should have them on the front side anyway. Probably not the back part. We won't need it, but the front side where you access the doors.
There is gutters up there, but
well, you don't want the gutters coming out with.
But it can slide off the gutters. So I think you guys can put that. What was that guy's name to put that building out?
Dave River,
yeah. They make ones that clip right under the ribs, you know, the bar type. Nice that you don't have to screw into the thing. But I can check and let you know, because I'll probably try to get paid apps to Lisa or something so that we can get a process the following week.
So I haven't been down there for a while. The port, Sallyport and the building, is there room for that we can start getting some of this furniture out of the storage and get it organized a little bit? And
they can put it in the front building as far as I'm concerned. But
what do you mean by that?
Put it in places they get it, you know.
Think we're going to have to get it out of there and kind of sort it out a little bit the way it sounded.
Well, the vehicle Sallyport paints, and then just... That's why I'm trying to get the contractors finished up, get them out of there.
Yeah.
So we get in there and finish the painting and get the electrical up. It's been packed all the time. I got all that kitchen equipment, but then the detention furniture should be out of there that where we can get it into the steel building sorted out.
When can we do that?
If you give me a week or two, yep. I think we can start getting it out of there.
I mean, just so we touch base with our people.
Jeff's coming down today. I think he talked to you about possibly start planting grass around that emergency generator putting some rock in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think he's going to call secondary road, see if they haul us in a load of gravel or some clean gravel and put it in there. Yep. I'm working with the contractor. I want to get the front dirt in the front so we can start doing some stuff up there. And then I'm just having them, whatever the sheriff and Andrew bring me, I bring the pricing to you, and you guys decide on what you want to do, whether it's blank hole, signage, or whatever. And I just get the pricing, and then you guys decide what you want to do.
I don't know if we need a sign. It kind of speaks for itself.
Huh?
I don't know if we need a sign. It kind of speaks for itself.
You know, we're just trying to get it finished up for you guys so we can get moved in and occupy the facility and hopefully start making some money.
Yeah. Well, we need to use it.
And get all bills done before July or June 30th.
I like that. I like that very much. So, that's all I had for you today, but if you guys want to come down there and go through it anytime, I'll let you know when we move that. Whatever we're bringing over to sort out.
Yeah.
And
yeah. I talked to one of the individuals that kind of put some of that in there. He said he'd be willing to come down and help us kind of sort it out. They were numbered and marked and in a certain way. But
well, that'd be good because it looks like it could be a little mixed
up in there. I would say.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, John.
Great day. Yep.
All right. We got Michael Storm patiently waiting, our Jackson County Emergency Medical Services Coordinator. Good morning.
Good morning. All right. So since last time we talked, we were in the middle of EMT and EMR classes. We finished those up and our students are in testing mode. So some of them have tested and been certified. Others are working with their own schedules and getting their certification tests. So hopefully we get some more certifies going in.
How many did we end up with?
We ended up with 9 EMRs and 5 EMTs that advanced to the testing portion of it. So we had more interest from college age, high school age students, you know. So they were asking me if we want to put on summer class too. I'm like, just got done with the class. But NICC was doing a hybrid class during the summer. So we're kind of directing them to NICC. I did talk to NICC, and if we had enough people from our area, the hands-on skills, I could do it over here in the hospital like I did during the winter class. And their lectures are online. So they basically keeping our residents from having to go up to NICC and make that trip all the time. So we'll see how much we get. I know Preston area had a few college kids that were interested. So so hopefully we kind of grow those numbers. Coming into the end of the year, fiscal year here, we start with system standards with our region. Every year we do what we want to work on for the year. So ours have been staffing since forever. And that's always tied to our grant that we get. So we get reimbursement for continuing education, initial education, et cetera. So we're working on that, finishing that up. So we can get that submitted for next year's grant cycle, as well as now that classes are over, I gotta send that documentation in to get reimbursed. So that grant this year, they were estimating 80 to 8,300, I believe. We put in that we thought we would have like 13. I just put what I estimated that we might have had students for. And we ended up with 9,100 that we'll submit. So if there's extra funds out there, they'll dish it out to us or they'll disperse it to other counties, sure. Not necessarily us. But so we added that up. That's what I've been working on. Just had a meeting last week with the county agencies, and they gave me some other jobs to do. Image Trends, our reporting software, finish up on that. County training, I'm going to wait till our July meeting, I believe it's in July, for that safety meeting, confirm exactly what they want for training here in the courthouse. And then I will be working department versus department to make flexible and meet whatever needs they learn. So They want, you know, during work hours, after work hours, whatever. I keep out of hours.
Kind of the CPR, AED.
Yeah, whatever. If they, you know, they talked about a little first aid and how in depth they wanted to go. Right. I gave Jim some of that information for the last meeting. I'll be there on July just to confirm. And then in the fall, we'll knock all that stuff out. That's pretty good. So, and then, yeah. Just working just met with my association last week. Everything seems to be going good. But in the summer, which, so education usually slows down a little bit in the summer, but they used also have different like disaster drills and stuff. So I'll be working with one media emergency management.
So you've been in contact with all the smaller departments and such and keeping them, if we call them system standards up to.
No. Yeah, absolutely. So they reach out as they, need this or just kind of their goal for whatever they need. The big push are when they have to renew and get inspected. That happened right before I got on, so I didn't deal with that. That's every 3 years. So we're just kind of maintaining the status quo. And I go out for trainings, go out to their meetings. Our association meetings are quarterly, but people reach out to me all the time.
So I know we've talked about this before, even the past individual. Do you have time or are you available sometimes for to be at a facility or?
As requested, yeah.
As calls, yeah.
Yep. So they have to, put me on the roster rate that I can respond. So I'm
sure
covered with the state and all that stuff. But absolutely, yeah, if they want to.
They know they have a day where a lot of their volunteers are going to be gone or something. If you're around or.
Yeah. They're having a department get together or, banquet or whatever. Bellevue just at fire department just had one. If they want that and so people can enjoy that, they don't have to leave. Absolutely. Sure. So, and
they're aware of that.
I made a letter, sent out to all departments, just basically saying when I started this position, what was this coordinator doing for you before? You want me to continue that? Is there anything you want added to that? And I make all those offers. Yeah.
Okay.
So is there a choice? Obviously, we can't force anyone to say, put me on your roster. I'm going to come run for you. But
maybe follow up with just kind of a reminder.
Yeah, I would like to.
I've been in this position now so many months,
Yeah.
Be willing to help you guys out a day here or there. If you're short or you got. Your main guys got doctor's visits or whatever,
Absolutely. And I make it a point to, when I meet with my departments, I go wherever they want. Now I go to you,
Right.
Sure. Don't have to come over here.
I just want to hear that you are interacting with all the facilities. Or
yeah, absolutely. Yep. I think I brought it up last meeting that, Delmer and Lost Nation joined our county association because, the hospital's ambulance covers all their district. Delmer was previously, but Lost Nation just got jumped on our reporting software. It doesn't cost any additional cost for non-transports to do. So we were getting those integrated and getting the bugs worked out and everything on there too. So
okay.
Yeah.
Any questions for Michael?
Going well and
appreciate it. Anything you need from us?
Not right now, no.
Any grants or refurbished AEDs out there?
Possibly the state never upped that grant again. The state always had a grant. But are you looking for what like type?
I had a church reach out.
It was a church. Okay. Yeah. I'll look for more for the churches because depending, there's responders. That was another thing. I was working with public health. I think the last time I talked to him, we're still kind of doing that on putting out the Stop the Bleed training and getting churches and schools specifically to apply for a grant where they can get Stop the Bleed kits, tourniquets and stuff like that. So I worked with assessors. We have a lot of churches or defunct churches. I didn't know what property, and I tried to find email addresses for all I could and sent that stuff out to them. So we got good returns. I was down at Easton Valley Elementary. I did all their teachers for Stop the Bleed. We did three sessions during their professional development days. So yeah, just kind of as I needed, I go wherever.
Cool.
So we're going
well. Yeah.
Thank you.
Keep us updated.
Yep.
Yeah, thanks, Dor. All right, Lisa.
This morning, I need a motion to approve the minutes of the April 23rd, 2024 board proceedings as written by Auditor Smith and authorized publication in the official newspaper.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
A motion and a second to approve the minutes and publishing as presented. All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
With the paving of the 308th Street street assessment project, this morning I need a motion to approve resolution number 1031-04-30-2024 for an operating transfer from the secondary road 308th Street assessment fund 20,001 to the secondary road fund 20,000 for $81,195.20 effective April 30th, 2024.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve resolution 1031-04-30-2024 as presented. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
This just transfers the money that was paid ahead for the secondary.
Yes. Yes. And that helps by the residents.
So yeah. this is what the residents have paid that have gone into this fund that now that the project is being completed. This money now will help offset that cost.
Okay.
So I received an email concerning a reimbursement for FEMA money. And this went out to Iowa Homeland Security. They took a look at all of the policies that we have, and they don't care for our procurement policy. So they sent us what they wanted in our procurement policy. Everything that we just passed is okay, but they wanted us to add the Buy America. So today I'm asking to approve and authorize board signatures on the revised Jackson County procurement policy, just so we can. They're holding $10,000 until we do this. So if we don't do it, they're not going to pay us. If we do it, yeah.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve revised Jackson County procurement policy as presented. All those in favor say aye. 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 Opposed? Motion carried. Does that also include the paragraph that was kind of part of it was deleted part of it?
We took care of that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. We took care of that also.
That was just a thing.
So. Honestly, I didn't even know that these things were submitted. So all of a sudden I didn't even know anything about it. And all of a sudden, so I called out and talked to this lady because some of the things that she had talked about in her email didn't make any sense. And she goes, oh, that's a mistake on my part. I said, okay, well, that's good to know because otherwise I was a little bit nervous. So hopefully with passing of this today, we'll get it sent back out and hopefully they'll release the funds.
And that's a federal one.
It's actually for FEMA.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. It's FEMA for secondary roads. And I haven't heard about FEMA for conservations. I don't know if they're going to hold that up or if they've already approved it. I don't know. So I also need a motion to approve setting a public hearing date for a fiscal year budget amendment on May 1st, 2024 at 10 a.m. And that's just kind of some end of the year cleanup.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve a public hearing date for fiscal year budget amendment on May 21st of 2024 at 10 a.m. Any further motion? I have a motion and a second. Any further conversation? Did you have a question? And again, we're coming to the end of the year, so again, it's normal that we get everything in place. And so we're...
Yeah.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
That's all
that
I have for the board
today. Thank you. And Luann. Good morning.
Good morning. You can get done and you can get outside today, right? Yeah. What I have for you today is the calendar. Tomorrow, Wednesday, May 1st. In May already, at 9 a.m. is an RTA meeting in Dubuque or by Zoom for all of you. There's a Wednesdays are possible meeting that's confirmed now, and it's actually at 4:30 rather than 4 o'clock. I changed it on your calendars for any of you that want to go to that.
It's in Bellevue up front.
Yeah, that's right. It's in Bellevue this time.
And, okay.
All right. At 6 o'clock tomorrow night is a 911 board meeting for Mike and Nin. And also added to the calendar is a meeting for Mike at noon tomorrow, a special ECIA council meeting, either in Dubuque by Zoom for Mike.
We have a courthouse security today, or safety today at 1.
Okay. I don't have anything else on the calendar until our next regular meeting, which will be next Tuesday, May 7th. And that evening at 7 o'clock will be the Board of Health meeting for Nin.
Okay. That's it?
I think that's it. I'm not sure why this is on here. I do have a letter here from Josh Bolt for the SSA. He's asking for the letter of support.
Yeah, I hope everyone had a chance to read it over. I talked to engineer and county attorney, and nobody has a problem with it. I'm in favor of our support.
All right, that's it.
Thank you. All right, any other business before the board?
We did have an RPA meeting, and they did talk a lot more about, they actually gave rather extensive, yet somewhat very elongated brief on those ports of eastern Iowa. And then, correct me if I'm wrong, but it basically sounded like it'd just be an avenue to help if, right now, along the Mississippi, Iowa doesn't have any actual like ports designated. Without the designation of a port, you're not eligible for certain grant funding and things like that. I forget his name, George or something. He was trying to promote to get everybody, because in Iowa, he says it's backward. The state, right now, they're waiting on a state designation is all they need to get it. They were on it for a couple of years. It changed, the requirements changed. He said right now what Iowa's missing is a state designation. And unlike other states, which usually can just pass it, they said this, the counties need to, like for so many of the counties affected need to approve it, then it'll kind of automatically qualify for a state designation. There was some question about funding and, you know, I asked about, usually when there's federal funds coming in, there's some kind of local match that's involved with it. And
he didn't really answer that very well.
It was just like, well, there's, you know, it's just, it's basically, it's another avenue to check a box so people can go out and fish for grant money. And then you have to apply with, abide by whatever strings attached to that grant money. He said it was essential. It seems like a lot of the Army Corps of Engineers use it. Because he was once affiliated with them, and he talked about it, helped getting $2 million for this and that with port designations. So
I was hoping the guy from DOT would chime in a little bit more on that, because that, when we brought it up before, that was Chandra's big thing, was that sometimes that takes away from other DOT funding you can get.
Yeah.
Well, and he didn't know if we really wanted to be doing that part of, you know, because of that. So,
but yeah. It seems like he was rather motivated in us doing something. And there was a couple of examples that he mailed out. One was the preferred one that they wanted everybody to sign. But if we just approved something, is what they were looking for. I think Scott County and a few of the counties, the ones they recommended, they had issues with certain things in it, and they were coming up with their own version.
I think that whole open-ended funding-ness is kind of a, you know, I don't want you to go and get a grant, and then we got to turn around and come up with
match funds
deal because they went and got this grant, you know, type of deal. So
and that the board, was the board, it has to be non-elected people. So
So there's seven counties. Each county would nominate or appoint a representative on there of this board, this Port Authority Board. And then they could, if somebody's applying for a grant, if they get a letter from the Port Authority Board, and we were asking questions like, well, who services as the administrators, who writes the stuff, who looks for the grants, who, yeah, sure, you know, is worth a lot of the answers. So that it didn't really, he talked for almost 50 minutes, and I don't think he really actually answered a question. But I could see the benefits of it, but I could see where.
I'm not sold on it yet, put it that way.
Yeah, having just a group of individuals pursuing money sometimes could get you into a lot of trouble.
Well, that's right. Chandra's take on it was, and he was going to come back with more information as he progressed too through it. So, yeah, hopefully they can come up with.
Well, he was in the room, so I don't know if he answered any quiz. His questions, but I'd love to talk.
Being so long, he kind of, people were zoned out after a while.
The guy loved to talk, that's for sure.
So, Iris is moving forward with the water up in Bellevue there, as kind of Nate said. They did have some things come up where some people, rather than connecting to their well, which is comes into the back side of their house, they wanted to know if the heater and stuff could come on the front side. So they're looking into that further as far as if it can go through all the legal channels to kind of make them changes, and then what the difference in fee structure would be to do that, because it would take a plumber to come inside and change the connection ports. So there might be some added cost to homeowners then if they wanted to do that. And that they would have to, a couple homeowners are like, well, we can do that ourselves. And we're like, well, for the grant and that, it kind of has to be certified plumber. So,
well, it's going to have to be inspected also. Right. So no, there can't be any feedback of any kind. You know?
So they're looking into all the legalities of that, but just be aware that that was brought up and people might be talking about that. So that's all I kind of really.
Well, yesterday we had gotten that email. I think it was yesterday. Yeah, first I heard of it, the special meeting tomorrow evening. I think the same night, same time as our 911 is. As far as the DNR sent out a special meeting for the, it's called a forest habitat rehabilitation project on the islands in the Mississippi. So I was kind of concerned if this was part of the Green Island project. So I got a hold of Nick for the DNR and Nathan from Conservation also, Nate Finney. And I forwarded on that email to you guys from this Nathan, I believe, or Ryan, his name was Ryan. So basically, it's promoting, they're having a special meeting, and it's promoting the forest health on the islands, and that were really damaged, tremendous damage, the last flood, I guess. So they're concerned about a lot of the timber in on the islands and such on the Mississippi. So just something to be aware of.
2 years before that wasn't as big a deal. It was only about 2 feet deeper.
Yeah, they must have had some significant damage last time around it.
Maybe the invasive combination of the two floods.
Yeah, an invasive issue. Species type thing. So I don't know. Maybe they're looking for something to do. I don't know.
They got extra money or anything.
Who knows?
Otherwise, I don't have anything else.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to adjourn. All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.